What's up, what's up? Bones and I are back today with an ATT video, otherwise known as Advanced Training Techniques. And today's topic is reps, or more specifically, what is the best rep range for building muscle? Is it low reps, is it moderate reps, or is it high reps? So let's jump into it. All right, so coming to the whiteboard here, you can see I already made some notes. So we can speed through this nice and quick. We don't have to wait for me to write everything out. So, rep considerations. What are the things that we should consider when we're talking about reps? Because it's more than just how many reps you do. So that's number one, quantity. How many reps per set? Well, there's more to it than that. Going to number two, let's talk about intensity. Because if I told you, do 15 reps, but you went over and you grabbed a light dumbbell and you just repped them out real quick, that's obviously not gonna get you the result you're looking for. So intensity is a key factor here when we're talking about building muscle. Next, TUT, which is time under tension. So what does that mean? On the concentric, the squeeze up, how long? And then how long on the eccentric or the negative on the way down, multiplied by the number of reps in that set. So that's gonna be your total time under tension. And this is a key factor, again, when building muscle. So we'll dive more into that as well. Last, number four on our list here is quality. So I'm not gonna jump into this yet. I'm gonna save that for the end because to me, this is the most important part, but don't skip to the end. So let's jump into a little bit of the science. Now, I don't wanna make this overly sciencey, but any of you guys that watch my channel know that I'm really big on explaining why. None of us just wanna be told to do something, we wanna understand why. So now we've all been told that there's certain rep ranges that you need to follow in order to either build muscle or to build size or to build muscular endurance. And there's a little bit of workout dogma here. In other words, that means that it's information that is preached over and over and taken as gospel, as fact, without any consideration that there's other possibilities out there. So what is kind of that workout dogma? Well, there's low reps for building strength, there's moderate reps for building size, and high reps for building muscular endurance. So what is that? Low reps is gonna be 5 to 8 reps, 80 to 85% of your one rep max. And that's supposedly to build strength, which when I say supposedly, it is true, but there's a little bit of flexibility here and we're gonna dive into that. Moderate reps, what is that? Well, that's 8 to 12 reps, 60 to 80% of your one rep max to build size. And then lastly, high reps, 12 to 20 reps, and the reason I capped it at 20 is if you follow my videos, you know that I actually do 20 reps as my first set, my recruitment set, and we'll talk about that later, but that's why I capped it at 20 reps. So that's anything under 60% of your one rep max, and that supposedly is to build muscular endurance, that you can't build muscle in this rep range, or it's not ideal for building muscle, and that's the dogma. So we're gonna talk about that. So, what's the next step here? Well, I think it's important that we understand muscle fiber types. So let's talk about that now. Three types here. There's type 1, type 2A, and type 2B. So what's the difference here? Well, type 1 is going to be your endurance muscle fiber. So what does that mean? Well, they're low power output, but high endurance. So think about a long distance runner. They're called a slow twitch oxidative muscle fiber type, meaning that they need oxygen. So when you think of like endurance athletes and you think of heavy breathing, that's why they're called oxidative. So you need oxygen in order to make these muscle fibers perform at their optimal level. Let's come to the other side. Let's skip type 2A for a second. Let's go to type 2B. So these are gonna be fast twitch glycolytic muscle fibers. Well, what does that mean? Well, that means that they're using glycogen or glucose as a source of fuel. These are high power, low endurance. So let's say that you're gonna jump or you're gonna sprint, you're gonna do something really fast. These muscle fibers are very powerful and they fire very, very fast. So we come to type 2A. What is type 2A? Well, it's actually a step in between the two. They're still fast twitch muscle fibers, but they take slightly longer to fire than type 2B. But they're a nice combination of the two between oxidative and glycolytic. So you've got type 1, type 2A, and type 2B. So now that we understand the muscle fiber types, how does our body use the different types of muscle fibers when we're trying to accomplish a goal? So for example, let's say that I'm gonna eat a bowl of cereal. So as the spoon goes into the bowl of cereal and it goes towards my mouth, obviously my body doesn't want to fire type 2B muscle fibers, which are very fast and very powerful. Otherwise, I'm going to jam the spoon through my eye. Don't want to do that. So what the body's going to do is it's going to use the smallest and slowest muscles first to accomplish the goal. But let's say that I'm trying to deadlift 500 pounds and do it explosively. Well, my body is then going to recruit as many muscle fibers as it can to accomplish the goal. And ultimately in the gym, a lot of times that is the goal, right? Activate as many muscle fibers as possible. I can kind of give you maybe a little bit of an analogy here. It would be like the difference between a locomotive that has multiple engines. So what if that train was very short and had a light load? Well, it's only going to use one of those engines to go ahead and pull that load. There's no sense in using two, three, or four of those engines to pull something that's very light. But if it's pulling a longer train, more cars, it's a heavier load, then you're going to see all of those engines firing up to accomplish the task. It's the same thing with our muscles. Why use more muscle than you need to accomplish the goal? But if there's more load, a heavier load to pull, then your body's going to recruit as many of those muscles as possible. So how does that work? Well, you're going to have to forgive my drawing here, but I'm going to try to give you an example. So let's say that this is a cross section of a muscle. Within that muscle, there's different muscle fibers within there. We'll kind of try to draw it a little bit better here. So you've got muscle full of muscle fibers. Well, within a muscle, they're actually what's called motor units. So let's say that we've got multiple muscle fibers here. Kind of looks like asparagus. Well, actually, it looks like something worse, but we won't talk about that. So multiple muscle fibers, and you have what's called a motor unit. So you'll have a neuron that fires those muscle fibers. And so that is a motor unit. Now, here's what's really interesting about motor units. They fire either all or nothing. So it's either 100% or it's nothing. Now, that doesn't mean that your whole muscle fires 100% or nothing. That's why we have multiple motor units within a muscle. So depending on the size of the muscle, you're going to have more motor units. So depending on what the task is, whether it's something very light, your body's only going to fire a few motor units. But if it's something heavy, like we talked about doing a deadlift and doing it powerfully, yeah, it's going to fire more muscle units. So again, it's all about efficiency. Your body's only going to use as much muscle as it needs to accomplish that task. Now, here's a side little tidbit of information, not to make this overly complicated. What makes a muscle fire and what makes you strong? People think about big muscles makes you stronger, and that's not entirely true. Your nervous system is just as important as the muscle itself. So think about this. Let's say in a house you've got 110 volts and you got 220 volts, so you got twice as much power. There's some things that you run in your house that won't run off 110. There's not enough power. It has to run off of 220. Well, it's kind of the same concept here with your nervous system. Your muscle can only be as strong as the impulse, that signal that's firing the muscle. So this is the cool part. This is what I was telling you that's really interesting. So the difference between a type 1 muscle fiber and either of the type 2 muscle fibers is the fact that the nerve that supplies them is different as well. So there's type 1 nerves and there's type 2 nerves. So if I were to take a type 1 muscle fiber and I were to go ahead and fire it with a type 2 nerve, that muscle would fire just like a type 2 muscle would. And vice versa, if I were to take a type 2 explosive strong muscle and connect it to a type 1 nerve, it's going to be low power output and high endurance just like a type 1 muscle fiber. So it's kind of interesting there that your nervous system plays a big part in how strong you are. So if you've ever seen someone who doesn't look very strong, but they're able to lift really heavy, a lot of the times that's a factor there. Their nervous system is very strong. And that's why if we go back up to the top there with low reps, that's a big factor in getting stronger. Like have you ever seen a power lifter that doesn't look like a bodybuilder? They don't carry the same kind of muscle size, but they're very strong. Well, that's because their nervous system is very strong, and training with low reps helps develop that neural strength. That's what you call it, neural strength. So just a little bit of tidbits of information here, kind of deviating. So let's move on to the next topic, which is going to help you understand why up there at the top, between low, moderate reps and high reps, why that isn't necessarily true, especially when it comes to the third category, which is endurance. And that's what fuels these types of muscles. So let's flip our board over and we'll take a look. All right, so there's three types of energy systems that power any activity. Number one, there's the phosphagen system. So this is using ATP, and we're not gonna dive into this because, I mean, we could turn this into a 2-hour lecture. So let's just keep it really simple. But just know at the end of the day that you need ATP to make your muscles fire. So remember that part. So that's step one, that's the phosphagen system. And we'll jump into the details in a second here. Number two is the anaerobic glycolysis. So this is where your body's taking glucose and turning it into ATP. So we have limited stores of ATP. As soon as we exhaust it, then our body's gonna take glucose and turn it into ATP. Because remember, you need ATP to make your muscle fire. So that's via glycolysis. The third is aerobic or oxidative energy system. So this is where our body is taking either glucose and or fats and then turning it into ATP via oxidation, meaning with oxygen. So think about the word aerobic. When you're doing aerobic exercise, you start breathing heavy, you start consuming more oxygen. That's because you need oxygen to produce energy at this level. Up here, these two are not oxygen dependent. So we're converting glucose or carbohydrates, ATP versus glycolysis, versus down here, it's oxidation that's converting glucose and or fats. And this is the important part when we're talking about cardio right here. So why do you do cardio to burn fat? That's why you wanna be in an aerobic oxidative energy system, because then you can use fats as a source of fuel. So these first two are important when it comes to weight training. So that's what we're primarily talking about here today. We're not talking about this. We'll jump in this a different day, especially we'll kind of expand on a conversation I had with you guys before about HIIT training. And that really is this world right here, which you'll actually start to understand a little bit as I explain this next chart. But first, let's talk about these energy systems. How does this work? All right, so system number one, our phosphagen system. We only have enough ATP for about 10 seconds. You know, it's that short burst of whether that's, you know, a quick sprint or jumping up in the air, or maybe, you know, 2 reps of a deadlift. That's gonna be our phosphagen system. So what happens after 10 seconds? Well, so 10 to 30 seconds, that's going to still be intense activity. This is very intense. This is still going to be intense. Now it's a combination of the phosphagen system plus anaerobic glycolysis. So now we're gonna start tapping in to our glycogen stores. And we all know about having to replenish glycogen after a workout. That's that post-workout meal, post-workout carbohydrates. It's important to replenish those. Why? Because right here in anaerobic glycolysis, we are depleting our glycogen stores or glucose or carbohydrates. Okay, so what happens after 30 seconds? Well, 30 seconds to 1 minute where the intensity is still heavy, that is just pure anaerobic glycolysis. Although there's no such thing as pure, so let me kind of back up. It's always gonna be a slight combination of these different processes. So it's primarily anaerobic glycolysis at that point. So I should even draw a thicker line here because this is where things kind of separate. Just like I said, they separate right here. But let's jump into it for a second. So what happens after a minute? So a minute to 2 minute, our intensity is moderate. This is anaerobic. So this would be like HIIT training right here. And even HIIT training comes into this realm a little bit for a second. And this is called this anaerobic threshold. Different conversation though. 2+ minutes, our intensity is light, and that's purely aerobic. So we're talking about this world right here. So why does this matter? Why is this important, and how does this have anything to do with muscle fiber types and what rep range we should be working out in? Well, if you look over here at this chart, so on the vertical, we have percentage of max energy production, and the bottom we have time. Now each of these correlate to what you have over there on the chart for duration. So peak energy production, but it only lasts a short time, is our phosphagen system. Okay, so that's number one. So immediate power, but it only lasts for a second. So as this starts to decline, what kicks in here? This, from this 10 second to 30 second, well, that's gonna be that combination of ATP and anaerobic glycolysis. So that's gonna be, and that's why you see at the peak here, it's in between that 10 and 30 seconds, but it doesn't just fall off a cliff, it starts to taper down. So that's that combination. Now, after that, what happens? So that 30 second to 1 minute, well, this is where the anaerobic glycolysis starts to kick in. So phosphagen system, combination of phosphagen and anaerobic, and our third phase is purely anaerobic. And that goes up to 60 seconds. Why is this important? I'm gonna jump into that next. But just for you that are curious, see this right here? This range here in between 60 seconds and 2 minutes, this is that anaerobic threshold. And that's what we're talking about in here. This is that difference between doing aerobic training, coming over here and saying, hey, I wanna burn fat, so I'm gonna jump on the Stairmaster and I'm gonna do 60 minutes. That's that difference between this versus anaerobic, which is gonna be HIIT, where you jump back and forth. You're jumping over that threshold back and forth. So you jump into the anaerobic phase, where you start to become more in this anaerobic glycolysis, but then you come back down, you bring your heart rate back down, and you go back into a regular aerobic state. So, different conversation, but I figured since it was here, I would show you. And so that's why anything 2 minute plus up to, you know, say, let's call it 60 minutes is gonna be just traditional aerobics. But coming back to this side, over on this side of the threshold, let's draw our hard line here, which is this hard line here, which is this right here. Why is this important? Well, let's flip the board back over and I'm gonna show you why. We're gonna do a correlation between this and muscle fiber types and reps. And so that's where we get into time under tension. So, this is actually, these are related up here. So low reps. 5 to 8 reps. Well, what does that mean for time under tension? Well, that's gonna be 10 to 16 seconds total per set. So how do I get that? Well, when you're doing low reps, this is explosive movements. If you watch power lifters, they're not concerned with doing slow negatives. So they lift it up and they set it down. So these are faster rep speeds. So you're typically looking at 1 second on the concentric, and then you're looking at 1 second on the eccentric. So for every rep, it's about 2 seconds. Multiply the 2 seconds by the reps, so you've got 10 to 16 total seconds. We come over here, moderate reps. Now we're talking about building muscle. We know that the eccentric or the negative is important for causing that micro trauma or micro tears in the muscle, which is going to stimulate protein synthesis. It's going to stimulate building new muscle. That's exactly what you want. We're trying to break down muscle in order to build muscle. So the eccentric is very important. So we're talking about a 1 centric or 1 second concentric, so a powerful concentric phase with a controlled negative. Now, some people even go to 3 seconds on the negative if you really want to emphasize it. But right here we have 3 seconds per rep. So 3 seconds times 8 and times 12, and that gives us our 24 to 36 seconds for total time under tension. Now, hang in there with me because this is really important. I'll get to the next step and you're going to see why this makes sense. Because everything I'm leading up to is more about this, high reps. Because I'm not gonna argue that low reps build strength, because they absolutely do, especially when it comes to that neural strength that we were talking about. What I'm talking about is high reps, and this is the question that always comes into play when I talk about my rep scheme, which is a 20, 10, 10, 15 rep scheme. So 4 total sets. First set, a recruitment set of 20 reps, 2 working sets of 10 reps, and a final set, 15 reps. It's like a burnout set or a finisher set. People always ask me, 20 reps and 15 reps, I thought those didn't build muscle, that those are only for muscular endurance. And this is where I disagree with all of this. Okay, I don't disagree with all of this. I disagree with this right here. And here's why. Total time under tension, 36 to 60 seconds, exact same formula that we had here. 1 second on the concentric, 2 seconds on the eccentric. So 3 total seconds per rep multiplied by our reps gives us 36 to 60 seconds. In other words, 1 minute total if we're doing 20 reps. So that's my set number one in my 4-set rep scheme, 60 seconds. I'm gonna flip the board back. Ready? Here we go. Where's our line right here? Bam. 60 seconds. So within 60 seconds, we're still able to generate heavy or high intensity. So 0 to 10 seconds, very intense. So that's going to be our lower rep ranges. But even then, but let's even talk about low reps for a second. 0 to 10 seconds. So that's our phosphagen system, ATP. So this should be like that immediate energy. Well, if we come back here, especially if we flip to the other side, let's look at that for a second. 5 to 8 reps. So what is that time under tension? Well, that's 10 to 16 seconds. 10 to 16 seconds. So again, coming back here, we're looking at this. This is 0 to 10 seconds. So already, even in low rep ranges, we're already here in a combination of phosphagen and anaerobic glycolysis. So that's even on low rep ranges. So let's not even worry about this top one. So let's just focus our energy on these two right here, these two energy systems, which is a combination of phosphagen and anaerobic glycolysis, and then just more plain anaerobic glycolysis. Okay, so this is our two ranges. Well, what's this total range here? So that's gonna be on the low end, 10 seconds, all the way to the high end, which is what? 60 seconds. Okay, I'm gonna flip the board. Where are we at here on our high reps, even at 20 reps? On the high end, 60 seconds. So when people talk about endurance, go back to the very beginning. When we talked about endurance training, we talked about type 1 muscle fiber types. We talked about low power output, high endurance. We talked about an endurance athlete, the little skinny guy, you know, that's out there running for, you know, 16 hours straight. That isn't this right here. So when we talk about endurance, yes, to a degree, muscular endurance, in other words, being able to do more reps maybe than if you just trained over here all the time. Yes, that's true. You just have to kind of reframe what endurance means to you. Yes, it means you're going to be able to lift those weights for more reps, but that doesn't mean you're doing endurance training here. My point to all this is this rep range right here still builds muscle. Now, to support that even more, what happens when you do high reps with a weight that really challenges you? Now, I'm not talking about just doing 20 reps just to warm up, because I don't do it that way. If you watch my videos, you know that set number one is that recruitment set. That's to go in there and to really challenge yourself. It's still a working set. So if I'm doing 20 reps, 15, I'm already dying, and then I squeeze out 5 more for a total of 20. So it's still a very challenging set. So this rep range right here is stimulating a lot of blood flow into the muscle, and that's giving you that nice big pump. So if you guys have done any of my workouts before, you'll notice that you get an incredible pump from that. Well, what's important about a pump and getting all that blood flow into the muscle? Well, besides delivering nutrients to the muscle, it's stimulating protein synthesis. If you look at some of the studies, that excess pump is actually more than just looking in the mirror and saying, hey, I look awesome, I feel nice and full. It's actually stimulating protein synthesis as well. So getting a pump, training with a lighter weight, is still gonna help you build muscle. Now, let's go back to our rep considerations here, because now we're getting into this part, and this is the part, this is the meat and potatoes, this is the part that I was telling you before was the most important to me. Forget all this stuff. Forget this side, forget the back side. That's the science. You guys wanna know why, that's the why. I'm gonna tell you the important stuff now. Coming in the gym is not rocket science. Building muscle is not rocket science. You don't even have to understand all this stuff in order to build muscle, because there's no scientific shortcut to doing it. You're not gonna find an easier way. What does it take to build muscle? Well, it takes going into the gym, hard work, pushing yourself, pushing past the burn, And so that's what we're going to talk about here. This is number four. This is quality. Quality of your reps. So what does that mean? Well, one, that means good form. So you're not just going in there and swinging weights around. That means isolation. So why is isolation so important? Well, let's talk about bench press, for example. If you guys watch my videos, you know I'm not a big believer in bench press. Why? Bench press is great for building strength, but overall strength. Why? It's very difficult to isolate your chest when doing bench press. You're using a ton of anterior delts and a ton of triceps when you're doing bench press. I'll give you a perfect example. Right now, I want you to flex your chest. Whether you do like, you know, most muscular or squeeze your hands together, do it for a good 15 seconds. Just squeeze them and really feel your chest contract. Feel your pecs just start to burn. That's what you should feel when you're working out. So, isolation, you want to isolate the muscle. So that's why I like to choose exercises where I can really feel it. You guys have seen an exercise I do. It's kind of a single arm. I don't even know. I've never come up with a name for it. It's not quite a fly. It's not a press, but I'm bringing my arm across the body because that's what your pecs do, is they bring your arm across your body. So figured out, okay, well, let me do something that really isolates that movement. And I take my other hand, I stick it on my chest, and I feel that muscle squeeze and get a peak contraction. And that's what I'm chasing, is that peak contraction. And that's number three on the list here, is peak contraction. So it's good form, it's isolating the muscle as much as possible and really feeling it squeeze. Anyone who's ever done a bodybuilding show and you go up on stage for whatever it is, you're only up there for like 3-4 minutes and you're hitting all these poses, you're hitting, you know, a double bicep. The next day and the day after, you are so sore because you flex those muscles so hard. That's what I think about when I'm working out. Every single rep that I do, I squeeze. I'm not relying on the weight or the range of motion to contract the muscle. I'm using my mind to contract the muscle. I can sit here and contract the muscles without doing any kind of exercise, right? That's making the muscle fiber or fire. Do the same thing with every rep. Make your reps quality. This isn't a counting game. This isn't math 101, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's not about counting, it's about quality. So, what is the big takeaway here? You need to learn how to feel. You need to learn how to feel the muscle, and this is that mind-muscle connection. You see this M&M here? That's what I'm talking about. Mind-muscle connection. That's the important thing. All this other crap, scribble across it, not so important. This is important. You want to build muscle, you have to develop that mind-muscle connection, learn to use good form, learn to isolate that muscle, and get peak contractions. That's what's going to stimulate muscle growth. You take a guy like 4-time Mr. Olympia, Jay Cutler, he and I have worked out on quite a few occasions. If you ask him, he'll tell you. He doesn't care about science and, you know, all this. All he cares about is getting that squeeze. He gets in the pocket, you get in the zone, and you start to feel it. So a lot of times people criticize him, say, hey, like on presses, he doesn't use full range of motion. Well, that's because he knows where that little pocket is where he can keep that squeeze and keep constant tension on the muscle. Out here, he starts to rest. He doesn't feel it the same, so he trains by feel. So he stays right in that little groove and just squeezes the muscle, and that's the important part. So don't always get caught up on the science or technique. With advanced training techniques, I explain to you guys how things work, but I'm only telling you not to give you some sort of miracle secret shortcut to the exercise. I want to explain to you guys why you're doing the exercise so you can kind of visualize in your mind what's going on so you can develop that mind-muscle connection, because that's the important part. So when it comes to the big question, what is the perfect rep range for building muscle? The answer is this: there is no perfect combination. The perfect combination is this right here: good form, isolation, and peak contraction. And I utilize all these rep ranges. I don't do as much low rep stuff, and here's why. I find that when I go heavier, I lose that feel. So why do I do a 20, 10, 10, 15? Well, the first set, that 20 rep set, I call a recruitment set. Well, what does that mean? Well, what I'm chasing in that set is I want to, if I'm doing curls, I want to feel that muscle burn. I want to feel that peak contraction. It's like, oh yeah, that's that feeling. When I jump up in weight and go down in reps to my second set, which is my first working set, I'm chasing that same feeling. If I don't get that same feeling, I know I'm going too heavy, that I'm struggling, I'm trying to recruit other muscles, and I'm swinging and using bad form, which we don't want to do, and I'm no longer isolating the same way, and I'm no longer getting that peak contraction. So what do? I drop down in weight, okay? So that's kind of like check number one. Am I using the right weight to get that feel? So then people ask me, set number four, why do I do 15 reps? It's not because of some scientific methodology of why I chose 15 reps. I go back to my original weight that I used for 20 reps, and I'm chasing 15 reps, which means 10 should be hard. 12 should kill you. 15, you've hit the wall. You can't do 16. Why? It's again, that's check number two. Because if I can do more than 15, that means I didn't push myself hard enough on set one, two, and three. So it's a check to make sure I'm using the right weight, that I'm pushing myself hard enough, as hard as I can, while still getting quality reps, good form, isolation, peak contraction. So that's why I train with 20, 10, 10, 15. And people ask me all the time, do you change it up? No, I pretty much stick to that. The only time I change is when it gets too complicated. Let's say I'm doing supersets or drop sets. Then I just go maybe to a standard rep scheme of maybe 3 sets of 10 or 4 sets of 10, and it makes it easier to combine other exercises. But for the most part, I always stick to 20, 10, 10, 15. And trust me, if you do it the way I'm describing it, you're gonna feel your muscles. Now, again, all this comes down to feel. Why do people have a hard time developing their lats? Because they have a hard time feeling them. They don't know what it feels like to get their lats to really, you know, contract strongly, get that peak contraction. So what do they end up doing? They end up recruiting a lot of other muscles. They're not getting that isolation because they end up using a lot of biceps and everything else, or even, you know, swinging at the hips back and forth trying to generate momentum, so they never get to feel that peak contraction. So what do I tell people when they're doing lat pull downs? Go lighter. Do your first set lighter and just focus on that squeeze and get that burn, get that peak contraction. That's the key. So when we're talking about considerations for reps, it's not all about quantity. So don't get caught up in that. So when you hear this, oh, I got to train in 5 to 8, or I've got to train in 8 to 12. I don't want to do this. This is endurance. No, don't worry about that. Worry about this right here. This is where it's at. This is money right here. So that is my long-winded speech on what is the best rep range to build muscle. So not exactly giving you the exact answer, but I am right here. Try this. Recruitment set. Pick a weight that you can only do, that you think you can only do for 15, and force yourself to do 5 more for 20. Now pick a weight where you get that same exact feeling that you got over here, and do that for these 2 sets. And finally, on your 4th set, go back to your original weight, and you should only be able to do 15, and if you can do more, then you didn't work hard enough over here. So that is the end of today's video. And I'm gonna be doing more of these advanced training technique videos again, kind of strayed away from them for a little bit. I was doing more of the vlogs. We were doing Games to Gains with Mike and Kirby. Then I focused on some of my goals with Mission Shred, and that was my goal to step on stage at the Arnold. But now we're done with those, and so we're moving back to advanced training techniques, talking about this kind of stuff, talking about techniques in the gym, help you guys build more muscle. And we also have some new cool content. I'm not going to tell you what it is yet, but it's going to be a new series, and it's going to be focused around how to find success in the gym and also outside of the gym. We're going to kind of combine the two a little bit. And I want you to check out a link in the description for this video. Check out a link. I'm going to put it in there. And in that link, it's going to send you to a page where you can ask me questions and you can also upload videos. What kind of videos? All right, I'm gonna tell you right now. In this new series, I'm going to be giving product away every single video. And I'm not going to tell you who I'm giving it to or what the criteria is yet, but just know that if you watch those episodes, I'm going to be giving product away every single video. So there's going to be an option there where you can upload a video saying, hey, James, I got my bottle. Thank you. Why? Because all of us question with all these different contests that you see out there, do people actually send the product to them? Do they actually get it? So I want you guys, when you get your bottle, upload your video and say, hey, I got it. Thank you. Say whatever you want to say, and I'm going to include that in my next video, so you guys will get featured there. There's also going to be another upload, video upload section. What's that for? Well, I again want to feature you guys. I appreciate you guys. I appreciate the comments, the feedback, the support, everything that you guys do. You are Muscle Geek Nation, and I appreciate you guys, so I want to incorporate you into my videos. So I'm going to lead off this new series every single video with a shout out from one of you guys. So you'll notice that there's gonna be an upload for that. What do you need to do? You just need to say what your name is, where you're from, and say you're watching Muscle Geek. That's it. So I'll feature you guys every single video in that new series. And then I'm gonna answer questions. If any of you saw 60 Seconds to Fit that I used to do with Muscle and Fitness Online, it's kind of similar to that. You submit your question, your training question, your nutrition question, your motivation question, cardio question, whatever it is, and I'm gonna pick a person every single episode and answer that specific question. So this is more of an opportunity for us to interact back and forth with each other. So I'm very excited about this new series. So check out the link down below in the description, leave whatever question you have, and I'm looking forward to this. I'm pretty pumped up, so that's coming soon. But in the meantime, we'll continue to do advanced training techniques every single week. So thank you guys.